Isaiah the prophet, foretold 850 years before our Lord Jesus Christ was born what he would be like as the suffering servant, as the one who would die to redeem Israel, the one who would be the lamb led to the slaughter. Isaiah 53. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death. Because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Amen. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May he bless our hearts with a deeper understanding of it. Hymn number 306. We'll sing all the verses. Alas, and did my Savior bleed? 306, and we remain seated. sin, but drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Here, Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do. Amen. King David was also a prophet, and he prophesied of the Messiah in Psalm 22. To the chief musician upon Ayelet Shachar, a psalm of David. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Why art thou so far from helping me and from the words of my roaring? Oh, my God, I cry in the daytime, but thou hearest not, and in the night season, and am not silent. But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. Our fathers trusted in thee, they trusted, and thou didst deliver them. They cried unto thee, and were delivered, they trusted in thee, and were not confounded. But I am a worm and no man, a reproach of men, and despised of the people. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the lip, they shake the head, saying, he trusted on the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. But thou art he that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breasts. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, for there is none to help. Many bulls have compassed me, strong bulls of Bashan have beset me round. They gaped upon me with their mouths as a ravening and a roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted in the midst of my bowels. My strength is dried up like a potsherd. My tongue cleaveth to my jaws. And thou hast brought me into the dust of death. For dogs have compassed me. The assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones. They look and stare upon me. They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture. But be not thou far from me, O Lord, O my strength. Haste thee to help me. Deliver my soul from the sword, my darling from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, for thou hast heard me from the horns of the unicorns. I will declare thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation will I praise thee. Ye that fear the Lord, praise him. All ye seed of Jacob, glorify him, and fear him, all the seed of Israel. For he hath not despised nor abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, neither hath he hid his face from him, but when he cried unto him, he heard. My praise shall be of thee in the great congregation. I will pay my vows before them that fear him. The meek shall eat and be satisfied. They shall praise the Lord that seek him. Your heart shall live forever. All the ends of the world shall remember and turn unto the Lord, and all the kindreds of the nations shall worship before thee. For the kingdom is the Lord's, and he is the governor among the nations. All they that be fat upon earth shall eat and worship. All they that go down to the dust shall bow before him, and none can keep alive his own soul. A seed shall serve him. It shall be accounted to the Lord for a generation. They shall come and declare his righteousness unto a people that shall be born, that he hath done this. Amen. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. May he bless our hearts with a deeper understanding of it. Amen. Hymn number 305, Jesus Paid It All.
And stain, hey, washed it white as snow. Lord, know indeed I find thy power and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim, I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you in deep humility. We do not deserve the right to enter your presence, but the blood of Jesus Christ has made the way open for us. His blood has been shed on the mercy seat of heaven. The veil to the holiest of all has been torn in two, and now we have direct access to you through the blood of Christ. And he is our great high priest, whoever lives to make intercession for us. Oh, Father, how we thank you. How we praise you. How we worship you. For you are worthy. We come today confessing our sins. We have sinned against you in our thoughts. We have sinned against you with our words. We have sinned against you with our actions. We have sinned against you with our motives. We have sinned against you with our attitudes. We pray that your Spirit would remind us of each of these, so that as we bow before you, we would with sincere hearts confess them as sin. Father, you have promised in your word that if we confess our sins, You are faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Gracious Father, thank you for that promise, and thank you that the blood of Jesus Christ cleanseth us from all sin. None excepted, all sin. Father, we thank you for Jesus who died in our place. We thank you that God the Son, the second person of the Godhood, came to earth. Through the virgin birth became a man. He lived among us a perfect and sinless life. And then as the spotless Lamb of God, he was sacrificed as the Passover Lamb in our place. How we thank you, Father, that he bore our sins, all of them. He died in our place where we should have had to have died. He bore your wrath, the pangs of hell that we should have had to experience. And you accepted his sacrifice as complete, as you proved by his resurrection from the dead. Father, we thank you. We do not deserve it. But you have demonstrated your great love wherewith you loved us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Thank you, Father. Fill our hearts with thanksgiving, with humility, and our lips with praise, that we might bring glory to the one who loved us and who gave us himself for us. In Jesus' name. Amen. Please turn to 312, hymn number 312. Calvary covers it all. 312.
The message that came to my heart, how that Jesus alone for my sin did atone, and Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My past with its sin and stain, my guilt and despair, Jesus took on him there, and Calvary covers it all. The stripes that he bore, and the thorns that he wore, told his mercy and love evermore. And my heart bowed in shame, as I called on his name, and Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My past with its sin and stain, my guilt and despair, Jesus took on him there, and Calvary covers it all. How matchless the grace, when I look on the face of this Jesus, my crucified Lord. My redemption complete, I then found at his feet, and Calvary covers it all. Calvary covers it all. My past with its sin and stain, my guilt and despair, Jesus took on him there, and Calvary covers it all. How blessed the thought, that my soul by him bought shall be his in the glory on high, where with gladness and song I'll be one of the throng, and covery covers it all. Covery covers it all. My past with sin and stain, my guilt and despair, Jesus took on him there, and covery covers it all.
Amen. If you're following along in your Bibles, I'll be reading from John chapter 16, verses 16 through 42. John chapter 16, verses 16 through 42. Then delivered he him therefore unto them to be crucified, and they took Jesus and led him away. And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of the skull, which is called in Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him, and two other with him, on either side one, and Jesus in the midst. And Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. This title then read many of the Jews, for the place where Jesus was crucified was nigh to the city, and it was written in Hebrew and Greek and Latin. Then said the chief priests of the Jews to Pilate, Write not the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am King of the Jews. Pilate answered, What I have written, I have written. Then the soldiers, when they had crucified Jesus, took his garments and made four parts, to every soldier a part, and also his coat. Now the coat was without seam, woven from the top throughout. They said therefore among themselves, Let us not rend it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be. That the scripture might be fulfilled, which saith, and we just read this in Psalm 22, they parted my raiment among them, and for my vesture they did cast lots. These things therefore the soldiers did. Now there stood by the cross of Jesus his mother, and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Cleopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciple standing by whom he loved, he saith unto his mother, Woman, behold thy son! Then saith he to the disciple, Behold thy mother! And from that hour that disciple took her unto his own home. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, saith, I thirst! Now there was a set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar, and put it upon hyssop, and put it to his mouth. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, It is finished! And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. The Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation, that the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was an high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken, and that they might be taken away. Then came the soldiers and brake the legs of the first and of the other, which was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus, and saw that he was dead already. They break not his legs, but one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. And he that saw it bare record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith true, that ye might believe. For these things were done, that the scripture should be fulfilled, a bone of him shall not be broken. And again another scripture saith, they shall look on him whom they pierced. And after this, Joseph of Arimathea, being a disciple of Jesus, but secretly for fear of the Jews, besought Pilate that he might take the body of Jesus. And Pilate gave him leave. He came therefore and took the body of Jesus. And there came also Nicodemus, which at the first came to Jesus by night, and brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 100 pound weight. Then took they the body of Jesus, and wound it in linen clothes with the spices, as the manner of the Jews is to bury. Now in the place where he was crucified there was a garden, and in the garden a new sepulchre, wherein was never man yet laid. There laid they Jesus, therefore, because of the Jews' preparation day, for the sepulchre was nigh at hand. Amen. Again, here ends the reading of God's holy word. May he bless our hearts with a deeper understanding of it. Please turn to hymn number 335. 335, Cross of Jesus, Cross of Sorrow. 335.
Cross of Jesus, cross of sorrow, where the blood of Christ was shed, perfect man on thee did suffer, perfect God on thee has bled. Hear the King of all the ages, throned in light ere worlds could be, robed in mortal flesh, is dying, crucified by sin for me. O mysterious condescending, O abandoned man sublime, very God himself is bearing all the sufferings of time. Cross of Jesus, cross of sorrow, where the blood of Christ was shed, perfect man on thee did suffer, perfect God on thee has bled.
Amen. Our scripture reading comes now from Revelation chapter 5. Here we see the Lamb, the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who was slain and yet is standing because of the resurrection. If you're following along, I'm Revelation chapter 5, beginning in verse 1.
And I saw in the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with 7 seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? And no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much,
because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon.
And one of the elders saith unto me, Weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof.
And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent forth into all the earth. And he came and took the book out of the right hand of him that sat on the throne. And when he had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sung a new song, saying, Thou art worthy to take the book, and to open the seals thereof, for thou wast slain, and hast redeemed us to God by thy blood, out of every kindred, and tongue, and people, and nation, and hast made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth. And I beheld, and I heard the voice of many angels round about the throne, and the beasts, and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000, and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power, and riches, and wisdom, and strength, and honor, and glory, and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven, and on the earth, and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, heard I saying, Blessing, and honor, and glory, and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb, for ever and ever. And the four beasts said, Amen. And the 24 elders fell down and worshipped him that liveth for ever and ever. And all of God's people here said, Amen. Amen. In preparation for the message, please take your hymnals and turn to number 320. 320. And this is the point at which the internet should be turned on, the DVD recording. Number 320. Let's stand to sing.
Beneath the cross of Jesus, I fain would take my stand. The shadow of Almighty Rock within. Of an awful grave that gapes both deep and wide, and there between us stands the cross, two arms outstretched to save, like a watchman set to guard the way from that eternal grave. Upon the cross of Jesus, mine eyes at times can see the very dying form of one who suffered. my smitten heart with tears, to wonders I confess, the wonder of his glorious love and my unworthiness. I take across thy shadow for my abiding place. I ask no other sunshine than the sunshine of his face. Content to let the world go by, to know no gain nor loss, my sinful self, my only shame, my glory, all the cross.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. The message today is entitled, 3 Days and 3 Nights. Our text is from the Gospel of Matthew. I'm reading out of Matthew chapter 12, and I'll read 4 verses, verses 38 through 41. Then certain of the scribes and of the Pharisees answered, saying, Master, we would see a sign from thee. But he answered and said unto them, An evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas. For as Jonas was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. And the men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation, and shall condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonas. And behold, a greater than Jonas is here. Amen. Just a few days ago on Palm Sunday, we showed how the resurrection was the sign that Jesus gave, proving that he had the authority to cleanse the temple. He had prophesied his own resurrection at the beginning of his ministry when he cleansed the temple the first time. He gave proof that he had the power to rise from the dead throughout his ministry when he raised others from the dead, such as the little 12-year-old girl and the son of the widow of Nain. To drive the point home, just before the triumphal entry, he raised Lazarus from the dead and had a very public dinner with him, a man who had been dead for days and was already decomposing. But to settle the question once and for all, he himself would have to rise from the dead. And friends, it was a startling, it was a terrifying event that roared across Jerusalem. You see, when he died, there was a massive earthquake. That earthquake, the Bible tells us, burst open hundreds of tombs and graves. And the veil of the temple, which was about the thickness of a man's hand, imagine a piece of cloth as thick as your hand, that veil was ripped from the top to the bottom. Now think about all those open graves. For 3 days, graves all over the city of Jerusalem were cracked wide open, where people could see the rotting, putrefying, stinking, fly-covered, maggot-eaten dead corpses. And then, here's something truly amazing. At the resurrection, the reverberating, awesome, supernatural power of Jesus' resurrection blasted the earth. And there's no question that it was clearly experienced by hundreds of people, because it sent a supernatural shockwave throughout the graves of Jerusalem. That concentric shockwave of his resurrection spun out in an ever-widening circle, so that the Bible tells us many dead believers in the immediate vicinity rose and went into the city and appeared to many. Was this a powerful event? Nobody could escape that clear statement that the judgment was coming and Jesus would raise all of the dead and would personally be their judge.
Listen carefully what the Bible says. I've just described it for you. Now listen, you'll see it here in the text.
Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks rent. It
means rocks were ripped apart.
And the graves were opened.
Can you imagine if that happened in this area and every cemetery, every grave was ripped wide open? There are hundreds of thousands of people buried in this area. What would that be like?
Many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of the graves after his resurrection. Those graves were open for 3 days. They came out after the resurrection and went into the holy city and appeared unto many. Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things that were done, they feared greatly, saying, "Truly, this was the Son of God."
Did you get it?
The graves were split open when Jesus died, but nobody came out until after the resurrection of Jesus. For 3 days, Jerusalem was filled with the stench of rotting dead bodies from hundreds of graves in every graveyard all over the city. No doubt there were frantic people running around trying to cover up all the open graves, but it was God's way of emphatically roaring the first truth of the gospel that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And the wages of sin is death. Until a man knows that he is dead in his trespasses and sins, he will never want a Savior. Christ died for sinners. And here was the graphic proof, the horrifying reminder that the wages of sin is death. Ah, friend, without the resurrection of Jesus, there would be no resurrection of anybody else. Without the resurrection of Jesus, there would be no hope for the future. And Paul puts it this way in 1 Corinthians 15, without the resurrection of Christ, we are of all men most miserable. Apart from this final mass resurrection that we see at the resurrection of Christ, the resurrection miracles that Jesus performed all preceded his own resurrection. And these alone prove that he had the authority over the Jews to cleanse the temple, which he called my Father's house. He, as God the Son, clearly had the right to drive out the squatters from the holy ground that was rightfully his, because he was the heir to the throne. He was the great high priest. The resurrection was also proof that he had authority over the Roman Gentiles, the Goyim, because he's the ruler of the nations. And not only so, he's the creator of heaven and earth and everything else, both visible and invisible. He created mankind, and he himself had already placed his own name forever on Mount Zion, the Temple Mount where he will rule. He clearly had the authority to do what he did. But to be resurrected from the dead, he had to personally die first. Not merely raise others from the dead, but personally to die first. And of course, then there's the question of application. Have you ever thought about this? What if he had merely died and risen again to prove a point? That wouldn't have done us any good. That would have only condemned us and proved that we're all sinners, that we were vile in the sight of a holy God. To make his resurrection applicable to us as sinners for the forgiveness of sins, he had to specifically die for our sins. He had no sin of his own. He was sinless. So his death had to be as a substitute to pay for our sin. Why is that important? Well, that makes the details about his death not only important but critical.
If the details are not true, the big picture is not true. Let me illustrate what I mean by that. Details make up pictures. Those of you who know anything about the way things are printed in color know that it's all a bunch of little dots that when you look at them from a distance, what you see is a picture. It looks all blended together, but if you examine it closely, it's little teeny-weeny dots of color mixed in different ways. So think about this illustration. Suppose there was a painting that was entitled, Lady Dressed All in White. Now, can you imagine in your mind a lady dressed all in white? Have you got that picture in your mind? But now you look at the picture. She's wearing a red hat. She has on a purple neck choker. She's wearing orange shoes. And her dress covers the spectrum of the rainbow with prominent black pig-shaped decorations all over it. The only white thing that she has is the hanky that she's carrying. Like the old saying goes, what's wrong with this picture? You see, the details are important to know the truth of the claims. We've just read a very important set of details in Matthew 12, verses 38 through 41. Let me read it again and see if you can grab hold of the details that tell us exactly when Christ was crucified and exactly when he rose from the dead. Just four verses, it gives us those details. Certain of the scribes and of the Pharisees answered, saying, Master, we would seek a sign from thee. But he answered and said unto them, An evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given to it but the sign of the prophet Jonas. For as Jonas was, I hope you're listening, 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be, are you listening? 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation and shall condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, a greater than Jonas is here. Now there are several important points that Jesus makes in these four verses. The first certainly has application to the modern charismatic movement. Verse 39 said, He answered and said unto them, An evil and an adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. The charismatic should read that verse. In fact, they should read a whole bunch of other verses too, to make sure we don't miss the point. Four chapters later, in the same book, in chapter 16, that first verse was in chapter 12, now we're in chapter 16. Jesus says the same thing to a different group of Pharisees and Sadducees. Verse 1, The Pharisees also with the Sadducees came, and tempting him, desired him that he would show them a sign from heaven. Skipping down to verse 4, what did Jesus answer? A wicked and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign, and there shall no sign be given unto it but the sign of the prophet Jonas, and he left them and departed. You know, Luke also gives another occasion where Jesus said the same thing. This is in Luke chapter 11, verses 29 and 30. And when the people were gathered thick together, he began to say, This is an evil generation. They seek a sign, and there shall no sign be given it but the sign of Jonas the prophet. For as Jonas was a sign to the Ninevites, so shall the Son of Man be to this generation. Three places we find it. If you're a sign seeker, or if you are following signs to run your life, Jesus says that you are evil, wicked, and adulterous. That's not pleasant, but you can't cut it any other way. Did you know the Apostle Paul also talks about those who seek a sign and specifically states that sign seeking is not a practice of the New Testament church now that Christ has come and fulfilled all that he promised at his first coming? 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22. For the Jews require a sign, but the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified. What are we talking about? We're talking about the death of Christ. We're talking about Good Friday. We're talking about the tombs opening as the graves crack. We're talking about Jesus being buried. What did Paul preach? He didn't look for sign. He wasn't looking out there for some philosophical answer to life's problems. The Jews require a sign. The Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified. Unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God. That's what answers that question of signs. And the wisdom of God, that's what answers the question the Greeks are seeking after. It's Jesus crucified. Magnificent passage. The second point that we see in those three passages out of the Gospels, out of Matthew 12, Matthew 16, and Luke chapter 11, it amazes me. Jesus, I'm not going to give you any other sign, but I will give you one sign. Jesus actually is willing to give a very specific and powerful sign to these evil adulterers so that they might know the truth. They want him to do a sleight of hand miracle, you know. Give us an entertainment show. We came here to see you juggle balls and make a rabbit come out of a hat. Jesus says, no, you're evil, you're adulterous, you're wicked. I'm not going to give you that kind of a sign. I'm going to give you a sign, the sign of the prophet Jonah. Says he was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, the Son of Man will be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. That's the sign Jesus gave at the beginning of his ministry. That's the sign that he emphasized all the way through his ministry. That's the sign that he demonstrated the resurrection. Now, the third observation on this passage. The sign that he would give was one they already knew and were familiar with. Jonah being swallowed by a specially prepared whale, at which time Jonah was out of commission for 72 hours. But if you think about it, the point that Jesus is making is much deeper than that. The way they knew about Jonah was because it was part of the Bible. In other words, Jesus points them away from flashy current event miracles, and he points them back to the Bible. The fourth observation that we can make is that Jesus gives a very precise time period, both for Jonah's belly cruise and for the time that he himself would be dead in the tomb. Jesus said that Jonah was 3 days and three nights. He didn't say two partial days, one full day, and two nights starting Friday. He didn't say that. The fifth and final observation that we want to make, although there are many others we could make on these passages, is the comparison that Jesus makes with the pagan, uncircumcised Gentile Ninevites, the Goyim, just like the Romans, and the then-present religious Jews who should have known better. The pagan Ninevites repented when Jonah preached after his little adventure. The chosen people, the Jews, refused to repent, even though Jesus was better than Jonah. In fact, Jesus says something that should have made them shake in their sandals. Jesus says that at the judgment, the pagan Gentile Ninevites who repented and got saved at the preaching of Jonah would actually bear witness against all the Jewish religious leaders who rejected God the Son when he came to them in person. Did you get that in verse 41? The men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation and shall condemn it because they repented at the preaching of Jonah, and behold, a greater than Jonah is here. Friends, these are all important details, but what I want to focus on is only one of the details. That's the time period that Jesus prophesied that he would be in the tomb. And to make sure that there was no mistake in what he said, he compared it directly with the time period that Jonah was in the whale's belly. So a question. Why did Jesus use Jonah as an example? That should be obvious. Jesus is talking to Jews. And Jonah was a Jewish prophet that they all knew about. In fact, the book of Jonah is part of the Jewish Bible. But you know, there's an even deeper observation that we can make. The Ninevites were Gentiles. They were outside of the covenant promises of Israel. However, these Gentiles did not reject God's message given through a Jewish prophet. Instead, they repented in sackcloth and ashes, all the way from the king down to the lowest person in the city. Think about this. Jonah only preached for 40 days. But Jesus preached for 3 years. The Jewish leaders in particular had ample time to examine his life, his testimony, his teachings, his miracles, and compare them with the things the promised Messiah would do. But remember, the Ninevites were Gentiles, and they repented. Although the listening audience of Jesus at the time didn't know it, especially as Jesus was preaching it, but God was about to open the door of salvation to the Gentiles when the Jews rejected their Messiah. Just like God opened the door to the Gentiles in the days of Jonah. But the principal thing we want to look at today is the exact time period that Jesus was in the tomb after the crucifixion. Jonah was Jewish. The people who heard Jesus preach and who screamed for him to be crucified were Jewish. Each of the four Gospels has a different target audience. The Gospel of Matthew, which mentions the 3 days and the three nights, was specifically written to Jews to prove that Jesus is the Messianic King and that he's Jewish. In other words, when we're talking about days, the 3 days and three nights, we're talking about how Jews understand them to be, how Jews use that term. God himself defined what he meant by the term day in the opening chapters of Genesis. God tells us when each day begins, and he tells us when each day ends. And remember, this same phrase is used for every day of the creation week, not just for Saturday or Sunday. I'll skip through the verses. Genesis 1, verse 5, God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. Now listen to the phrase, and the evening and the morning were the first day, Yom Echad. Verse 8, and God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day, Yom Sheni. Genesis 1, 13, and the evening and the morning were the third day, 19, and the evening and the morning were the fourth day, 23, and the evening and the morning were the fifth day, 31, and God saw that everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good, and the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Are you getting the idea? Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and the host of them, and on the seventh day God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made, and God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made, and Jesus was the creator according to the word of God. John 1, verses 1 through 18. I think as you read those passages, it's pretty straightforward that God is talking about 24-hour solar days. In fact, you may recall that several years ago when we did not schedule a creation conference like we usually do with an outside speaker, I preached a message on the meaning of the word day in Scripture. Now, I'm not going to preach that message again here today. A lot of verses on day. But we'll simply assume that from all we've studied in the context in detail. In fact, every occurrence in the Hebrew Old Testament in this kind of narrative context where the word day is found refers to what we would call a 24-hour day. For example, there are only a few technical passages where the word day occurs in a prophetic context. That's different. Such as the day of the Lord, where day means something about a specific eschatological message, something that is referring to a content of a series of events all balled together, or where day refers to something that is a specific bounded period. That's why Peter, for example, states that the day of the Lord, referring to the millennium, is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is a day. But when we're talking about a normal day, which is obviously what Matthew's talking about, Jesus wasn't in the tomb for 1,000 years, Obviously, Matthew's talking about a normal day. In our context, the Jewish time reckoning of a day begins with the appearance of the first star in the evening and ends with the appearance of the first star in the evening the following day. The day begins when we say, night is coming on. Oh, there's so much we could draw out of that also. Because we were in night and darkness when we began, and we got the light of the glorious gospel of Christ. We end in the light, not in the night. But I won't go there right now. Second, Jesus said he would be buried for 3 full days. We know this for 3 reasons. Number one, because Jesus is speaking to Jews who would understand day in the context of Genesis and the Old Testament, unless the context demanded otherwise. Number two, he speaks of both days and nights to make sure that we understand that we're not talking about partial days. And number three, he gives the real, literal, historic example of Jonah. Third, we're given specific time markers in the New Testament text as to when Christ died and when he rose. Let me read you some key verses from all 4 Gospels. Matthew 27, verse 45. Now from the 6th hour there was darkness over all the land until the 9th hour. And at about the 9th hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani? That is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Immediately after that, he takes the sponge of the vinegar and cries with a loud voice, yields up the ghost. The veil of the temple is torn in two. The earth quakes and the rocks split. John 19, 2 verses. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, it is finished. And he bowed his head and gave up the ghost. Now listen carefully to verse 31. The Jews therefore, because it was the preparation that the bodies should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day. Now listen to this next phrase. For that Sabbath day was an high day. Do you know what that means? We'll talk about it in a minute. Besought Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Mark 15, beginning in verse 42. Now when the even was come, because it was the preparation, that is, the day before the Sabbath. On the day before the Sabbath. We've been told that that Sabbath was an high day. Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, which also waited for the kingdom of God, came and went in boldly unto Pilate and craved the body of Jesus. And Pilate marveled if he were any while dead already, and calling unto him the centurion, he asked him whether or not he had been any while dead. And when he knew it from the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph. And he bought, that is, he purchased, remember that word, fine linen, and took him down, and wrapped him in the linen, and laid him in a sepulcher which was hewn out of a rock, and rolled a stone under the door of the sepulcher. All of that had to be done before the first star came out that marked the beginning of the high day Sabbath. Before, because he took the body down, it says he had to go out and buy fine linen. Nobody pre-planned this. They weren't ready for it. They had no idea what to expect, and suddenly Jesus is dead. Joseph had to go out and buy linen to wrap the body and bury it before the Sabbath started. And then they wrapped him, and we've already found out how Nicodemus had gone, while Joseph was buying the linen, Nicodemus went out and bought 100-pound weight of spices, and then together, those two wrapped the body with these spices inside of it and put it in the sepulcher and rolled the stone in front of the door before the Sabbath would begin. They were cutting it close, just like I was cutting it close trying to get here today. Luke 23, beginning in verse 52, this man went unto Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. And he took it down and wrapped it in linen and laid it in the sepulcher that was hewn in the stone wherein never man was before laid. And that day was the preparation, and the Sabbath drew on. They're moving fast. They're in the preparation day. But the Sabbath is coming. Remember, the Sabbath starts in the evening with the coming out of the first star. And then, listen, it says, and the women also, which came with him from Galilee, followed after and beheld the sepulchre. So in other words, they don't get their stuff started until after Jesus is buried in the sepulchre. And they returned and prepared spices and rested the Sabbath day according to the commandment. Now wait a minute. Where'd they get the spices? Because we discover in Mark that they had to go out and buy spices. Mark 16, beginning in verse 1. When the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, bought, B-O-U-G-H-T, not brought, bought, they purchased sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, Sunday is always the first day of the week. Sunday is never the Sabbath unless it's a high holy day. Sunday is the first day of the week. Christians do not worship on the Sabbath. We worship on the first day of the week to celebrate the resurrection of Christ. The Jews worship on the Sabbath, which is the seventh day of the week, because God rested the seventh day of the week. But we worship on Sunday because Christ rose from the dead on Sunday. Sunday is not the Christian Sabbath. In Scripture, Sabbath always refers to the seventh day of the week, unless it's one of the seven high holy days. Very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. Now let me make a few more very careful observations, and I know our time is running. When Jesus actually rose from the dead, none of the women and none of the disciples were present. Have you ever thought about that? When he came out of the tomb, the women weren't present at the moment he broke forth, and the disciples were not present. Now, the guards placed by the Sanhedrin were present when the angel rolled the stone away and sat on it, scaring the willies out of the guards. But Jesus didn't need to have the stone moved to get out. In his resurrection body, he could walk through solid doors, as we see later in the Gospels. The stone was rolled away so that the guards and the disciples could see inside. Now, while all this is going on, the guards ran away. They told the Jewish leaders who bribed them to say that the disciples came at night and stole the body while they slept. Right. That's a capital offense. It's a capital offense to fall asleep while you're on guard duty. And that means that the entire cohort of soldiers fell asleep at the same time. For that to happen, all the soldiers would have had to have been dead drunk, on knockout drugs, totally exhausted to be able to sleep through the noise of 11 men, that's the disciples, remember, not Judas, but the other 11, that 11 men were banging around in the dark, tripping over the guards, hacking ropes, cutting Roman seals, and doing the old heave-ho grunt on the count of three to roll a rock weighing at least a ton uphill in a guide trough. You ever thought about that? And then propping it up with more rocks so they wouldn't roll back, which is a rather stupid thing to do if they didn't want the guards to know they stole the body. They could have just rolled the stone back down and the guards wouldn't see it. And then they would have had to have, when they went into the tomb, you remember what the disciples found? They found the linen grave clothes lying there, and they found the napkin for the head in a separate place by itself. They would have had to have unwrapped the body. Well, the guards are asleep outside. They would have had to have unwrapped the body, being careful not to spill 100 pounds of spices all over the floor. And then they would have had to have neatly wrapped that cloth back up again, making sure that all the spices were tucked in there, and then pushing it down flat to make it look like the body had come up through the cloth. I mean, if you believe the Jewish guard story, you... Let me sell you a piece of oceanfront property in Nevada, okay? They would have had to have done all of that. And then they would be carting off a naked body, which had blood all over it, and getting clotting blood all over themselves, which would have been a dead giveaway that they'd been up to some kind of mischief. Like, hey, Peter, when was the last time you had your tunic out for good dry cleaning? To do all of that would have taken at least an hour or more. And then the corny disciples, the corny story. His disciples came while he slept, while we slept. Really? So if you were asleep, how do you know it was the disciples and not a Roman Catholic grave robber looking for relics to sell at cathedrals over the next few hundred years. Folks, that story is still passed around among Jews today. There's a guy named Hugh Schoenfeld who wrote a book called The Passover Plot, which he basically repeats the same kind of a story. You have to get through all of that problem there. It's not just the disciples came in and 30 seconds later they had the body of Jesus and they were out of there. Look, the grave clothes were left behind in perfect order with all the spices in them. And the stone was rolled out of the way. And you can't do that in silence. 11 guys are going to make a bunch of noise doing that. So that brings us to the timing. There are several important keys to notice. The traditional view that puts the crucifixion on Friday claims that part of a day, that's Friday, counts as a day. And so a few minutes before sunset on Friday means one day. Then all of Saturday means day two, that's reasonable. And then they say just after Sunday had started, a few minutes after sunrise on Sunday means day three. So we got two partial days and one whole day. The proponents of this view claim that they have their 3 days, but wait a minute, what did Jesus say? It would be 3 days and three nights. In the proposed scheme, there are only two nights, not three. And no matter how you twist it, you cannot get three nights out of a Friday crucifixion and a Sunday resurrection, and we know it was the first day of the week when he rose, which is Sunday. There are also several other problems that the Friday crucifixion can't answer. Have you ever noticed the different timing that is given from Mary and the other women who visited the tomb? It's clear from the described events that they did not come together. John says that Jesus had already risen while it was still dark. In other words, there was no partial morning light when Mary saw the empty tomb and then ran to tell Peter and John. In other words, Jesus had risen while it was still dark, since Sunday, the first day of the week, had actually started at sunset about 12 hours earlier. The guards were already out of there. John 20, verse 1. The first day of the week cometh Mary Magdalene early, when it was yet dark, unto the sepulchre, and seeth the stone taken away from the sepulchre. Guards are already gone. Then Peter came and left, and then when the other women came, the sun had already begun to rise. It says so in Mark. It wasn't dark. Then when the Sabbath was past, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James had bought, B-O-U-G-H-T, sweet spices, that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came unto the sepulchre, now listen to this phrase, at the rising of the sun. Wasn't dark anymore. Rising of the sun. By the way, I mentioned to you as we read through the passage, Joseph of Arimathea bought the linen to wrap Jesus in before the burial, before the sundown, according to Mark chapter 15, 46. But the women, how could they, who they followed and watched the whole burial, how could they have gotten back to the city and bought spices before the first star came out? Joseph and Nicodemus barely made it on time. Also, if you've noticed the different timing of before and after the Sabbath in relation to what the women were doing. Luke 23, 55 and 56 says the women watched the body of Jesus laid in the tomb just before sundown and then returned and prepared spices and ointments before the final preparation of the body. But it appears they didn't do it that day. In fact, that's very important because Luke seems to imply they prepared spices before the Sabbath started, but Mark implies they did it after the Sabbath. So how is it possible to have it both ways? It's possible. I'll explain in a minute. The women clearly did not have the spices or oils on hand because Mark said they had to go out and buy them first. And that must have taken place after the Sabbath. They would not have actually purchased or prepared spices either on a high Sabbath, that would be super sacrilegious, or on a regular Sabbath, since that would violate Sabbath law. So which was it? Did they prepare before the Sabbath, or did they prepare after the Sabbath? Look at the contrast that Mark makes with the passage we just read in Luke. When the Sabbath was past, So this is after the Sabbath. Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, had bought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came into the sepulchre at the rising of the sun. I hope you understand the tension here. This is one of the things that the critics point to. It's easily explained. The question, when did they buy the spices? If Jesus was buried on Friday and they followed Nicodemus and Joseph of Arimathea all the way to the tomb and watched Jesus hastily buried just before sunset, they would not have had time to run back into the city and buy spices. Why? Well, obviously, all the Jewish merchants would have been closed by the time they got back from seeing where Jesus was buried. The Sabbath would have already begun. The women could not have bought and prepared the spices and ointments on the actual Sabbath, beginning at sunset and running through till the next sunset. But Mark indicates that they purchased and prepared the spices and ointments before they got to the tomb, when the sun was starting to rise. The Friday crucifixion view, it fails to give any time in which they could have purchased the spices and prepared them. A process that would have included buying them, bringing them home, grinding them up, mixing them with fragrant oils, and packaging them up to carry to the tomb. In other words, if they got back to the city after dark on Friday, the Sabbath would have already begun. No buying or selling or preparing was permitted. You say, well, maybe they bought them from Gentiles. Maybe the Gentiles still had an open shop. Did you know that the book of Nehemiah had already established the Sabbath law all the way back in Nehemiah, chapter 13, verses 15 through 21, to apply to non-Jews trying to sell things in Jerusalem as well as to the Jews? When he closed the gates, he said, you're not going to do this anymore. And they still came to the gates. He said, if you come one more time on the Sabbath day to try to sell stuff, he wouldn't let them in on the Sabbath. You come one more time, I'll arrest you. And so they didn't come back anymore. That law applied to Gentiles as well as to Jews. And so sunset on Saturday came, and still no shops were open. So if he's crucified on Friday, and they have to go all the way through Saturday, they can't buy on the Sabbath day the spices on the Sabbath. And then they come to the tomb just as the sun is breaking over the horizon. There's no time to prepare the spices. The shops in the city are just starting to open. No time to buy or sell or prepare. So how do we solve the problem? Actually, it's not a problem if you recognize, as is clearly stated in the text, that there were two Sabbaths that week. There was the high Sabbath that John mentions. There was the regular Sabbath, and there was one day between the two Sabbaths. Let me lay it out the only way that we can have a clear synthesis of all the different eyewitness accounts. Number one, it says Jesus was crucified on the preparation day before what is called the high Sabbath, not a regular Sabbath. Passover, Pesach, is one of the seven high Sabbaths of the Jews, and it does not always fall on the same day of the week. John 19:31, the Jews therefore, because it was the preparation that the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that Sabbath day was an high day. Number two, the regular Sabbath always begins at sundown, often understood by the Jews to be the appearance of the first star, on Friday night, and it ends at sundown, first star, on Saturday night. That's clearly stated in the law. God commanded it in Leviticus 23:32. You shall do no manner of work. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations and all your dwellings. It shall be unto you a Sabbath of rest. You shall afflict your souls. I mean, and he tells us that the Sabbath, at the end of the book of Deuteronomy, is a sign between God and the Jews, not between God and the church. However, there are seven different annual holy days which are listed in Leviticus 23, and these are also called Sabbaths. The Jews go through many preparation rituals for a regular Sabbath, but the preparation is even more intense for one of these high holy days, the annual festivals of Sabbaths. These high Sabbaths do not always fall on Saturday. They can fall on any day of the week. How do we know that? Because we saw it this very week, just a couple of days ago. We saw Passover fell on Tuesday, April 11th, just 4 days or 3 days ago. That was a high holy day for the Jews. It actually began the seven-day feast of unleavened bread, which is welded to Passover. High holy days don't always run from Friday through Saturday evening. Again, this year the first day of Passover was on Tuesday. It was a special high Sabbath at Jewish synagogues all over the world. If you were listening to the radio, you probably heard some special Jewish services being broadcast. The Passover Sabbath is the high Sabbath day mentioned in the text because Jesus fulfilled Passover as the spotless Lamb of God. And Paul tells us that Christ, our Passover, is crucified for us. The text in John 19:31 clearly states that the approaching Sabbath when Jesus died was an high day. The brilliant Christian Jewish scholar of a generation ago, Alfred Edersheim, posits that when Christ cried, "It is finished!" at that very moment, the high priest slew the Passover lamb in the temple in preparation for the Passover meal that night. So let's put it all together now. If Christ was crucified on Wednesday, which I think he was, and died just as the Passover was officially beginning the slaying of the lamb, between 3 p.m. with the burial shortly before sunset, the first high day would have run from sunset on Wednesday night to sunset on Thursday night. In the Jewish calendar based on the 7 days of creation passages we saw in Genesis, Friday begins at sunset on Thursday night and runs to sunset on Friday night. That gives an entire day, all day Friday, for shopping and preparation on that day between the high day, the Passover on Wednesday, and the regular Sabbath, which is Saturday. The first day of the week begins sunset on Saturday night and ends on sunset on Sunday night. That also solves at least seven other major problems raised by a Friday crucifixion. Number one, it gives an actual, precise, and full 24-hour 3 days and three nights in the grave, instead of 2 days consisting of only a few minutes, one full day, two nights at the maximum, and then a few more minutes. This is important to the doctrine of the inerrant inspiration of Scripture, to the accuracy of both the words of Christ and the accuracy of the Bible book of Jonah, which states in Jonah 1:17 that Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly. Jesus didn't make it up. That was in Jonah. Number two, it means that Christ was speaking and prophesying literally and accurately. If he was only in the tomb for 1 day and a few minutes, protruding slightly into other days on either end of 1 day, the most important sign that he gave, proving that he was the Messiah, is therefore not literal, not true, and therefore not fulfilled. It solves the third problem. It harmonizes the before and after statements that appear in the various Gospels. It solves problem number four. It provides a day in which the spices could be purchased and prepared. It solves problem five. It harmonizes the high day Sabbath with an additional regular Sabbath because the Bible clearly states that Christ rose on the first day of the week, which is always Sunday in the Bible. In other words, sometime after sundown on Saturday night, because he was already risen from the dead when Mary got there in the dark and the guards were already gone. It solves problem number six. It means that the women did not violate Sabbath law. It solves problem number seven. It answers the question as to why neither Mary Magdalene nor Peter and John nor the other women ran into any of the guards who were watching the tomb. I'll close. When you carefully study the Bible, the answers are all there. The different perspectives of all the writers are in faithful harmony, and all of their additional details make for the complete picture without conflict. This is what gives you and me, the examiners, complete confidence in the authenticity and the authority of the Scriptures. And that means, as we celebrate this day of remembering Christ's death, that we can have complete confidence in the Scriptures when we read, "Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures." Amen. Our gracious Heavenly Father, how we thank you for the precise, accurate, literal fulfillment of prophecy, the greatest sign in all of history, which is the grounds and foundation for our salvation. For if Jesus had died but never risen from the dead, we would have no hope. It would have merely been a claim that was not fulfilled. And yet, according to your word, as prophesied by David 1,000 years before Christ, as prophesied by Isaiah 850 years before Christ. Christ took our place, bore our sins, died on the cross to pay the penalty, and 3 days later, and 3 nights later, rose from the dead, guaranteeing eternal life to all who believe. Father, we thank you for this. In Jesus' name, amen.